Okay, thanks everybody for making it out. Thank you to Hu Guo, our speaker today, who will be talking to us out of Georgia Tech about packing nearly optimal Ramsey R3T graphs. Go ahead and take us away.
And it's a nice screen.
Yep, looks good.
Following invitation on the introduction. Today I'm going to tell you about constructing triangle-free graphs in our pseudo-random properties in dense graphs, where previous results only get such construction in complete graph. It is like in the intersection of random graph processes and random theory. But I'm beginning, let me just put the definition of random number into context. So random number RST is the mean number n, such that for every red and blue edge coloring of a complete n vertex graph kn contains either a red ks or blue kp. On understanding the behavior of random number, it's a major problem in combinatorics, and it is well known to be very difficult even to determine the asymptotics of it. And a separate result in random theory is that the order of magnitude of the random number R3T is U squared over log T, where the upper bound is due to a pi Kamlosh and Samarady in 1980. Or the lower bound is due to King in 1995. Nowadays, we have a much better understanding of the random number R3T due to work of Bowman and Kibash, as well as Andrewaris, Griffith, and Morris. But today, we only focus on the order of magnitude. And indeed, the proof technique of the random number has been very influential. And for the upper bound by a pi Kamlosh and Samarady in 1980, it was considered to be the first serious application of semi-random approach. Well, for the lower bound, Erdős already in 1961 used a clever alteration method to find the random number RCT, roughly t squared over log t squared. As you can see, there is an actual log factor in the denominator. And later on, this result was reported by Spencer in 1977 using lowest local lemma. And in 1984, Grigorovich used an even simpler art deviation approach to report this result. Well, finally, in 1995, he managed to get the correct lower bound by removing the log factor. And King combines semi-random variation of triangle-free process with concentration inequalities and differential equations. And for King's major achievement, King also received the Folkson Prize in 1997 for this result. And the topic of this talk is to introduce an extension of King's result, which implies asymptotics of some other random parameter. Again, by removing some log factor. So, is there any question at this point? All right, then we will move on. Before introducing our result, let me briefly reveal some of the previous results. So to find the lower bound of R3T, people have done the following thing. Erdős in 1961, Spencer in 1977, and Grigorovich in 1994. All of them found an n-vertex graph G in the complete graph Kn, such that the graph G is triangle-free and with independence number at most some constant C times square root of n times log n. And all of them construct such graph G in the binomial random graph GNP model, where the binomial random graph GNP is the graph that you included each edge of the complete graph Kn independently with probability P. And later on, their result was improved by Kim in 1995 and reproved by Bowman in 2008. Both of them found an n-vertex graph G in the complete graph Kn, such that the graph G is still triangle-free, but with smaller index number compared to the previous result. So as you can see, there is a logarithmic improvement over here. And Kim and Bowman's result is nearly optimal. It means the index number is tied up to the constant C by the result of a tie conversion similarity. And this result also leads to the right order of magnitude of the random number R3T they discussed. And before introducing the proof idea of Kim and Bowman's result, let me mention that why such a result is difficult. So for example, if you want to prove such a result by a standard approach, the alteration method in binomial random graph GNP, then you will try to remove one edge from each triangle, distract all the triangles, and get a triangle-free graph. But here are some facts. We know that with high probability, the number of edges in binomial random graph GNP is roughly n choose 2 times p. And the number of triangles is roughly n choose 3 times p to the cube. And because we want removing one edge from each triangle, the resulting graph does not have large independent side. Therefore, it's natural to assume that the number of triangles is much less than the number of edges, so that the resulting graph does not have a large independent side. But that will imply P is roughly 1 over square root of n. But here is another fact. We know that with high probability, the maximum independent side of binomial random graph GNP is roughly 2 times log n over P. And if you plug this P in, you will figure out that the index number is roughly this one, which is similar as the previous result, which is much larger than our targeting bound. So that's why the previous proof based on binomial random graph GNP does not lead to the correct independence number. So that's why Kim and Bowman need to use some refined way to prove their result. And both of them use the idea of triangle-free process, where the idea of triangle-free process is simple. We start with an empty graph, and at each step, we add one random edge that does not create a triangle. And then we repeat. And here I will illustrate the process for you. So for example, at the beginning, we have not chosen any edges, and all the edges are available to choose, and we call them open. It means each of them can be added. And at each step, we add one random edge, for example, this one. And then at next step, we add another one. At third step, we add another one. But at this moment, you can see that these two edges become closed, because adding them will create a triangle. So we call them closed edges, and they will never be added. And then we continue. Add this edge, and this one becomes closed. And that is the triangle-free process, and was applied by Bowman in his 2008 proof. Well, much earlier, King used a semi-random variation of triangle-free process. Where semi-random means at each step, instead of adding just one random edge, we add many random edges at each step. For example, at one step, we had many random matches at each step. So that is the difference between team and Bowman's proof. Well, instead of finding just one nearly optimal R3T graph as Kim and Bowman did, we found almost a packing of nearly optimal R3T graphs. It means given an epsilon greater than zero, we can find a collection of edge disjoint graphs Gi in the complete graph Kn such that each graph Gi is nearly optimal R3T graph. It means Gi is triangle free on this small index number. And secondly, the union of the graph Gi in this collection contains at least a 1 minus epsilon fraction of edges of the complete graph Kn. And that is our unpacking result. And the idea to prove our unpacking result is simple. Actually, we start with H0 equal to the complete graph Kn. And then we find the graph Gi in this collection in Hi by a semi-random variation of triangle free hook size. And then we remove edges of Gi from Hi to get H at plus one, and then we repeat. Therefore, we can obtain our packing result by a simple polynomial time random maths algorithm, not just showing the existence. Is there any question about this unpacking result? Okay, then we will continue. And what is the motivation? Why should we care about such packing result? Well, first of all, packing objects in random discrete structure has been a recent trend. Usually, people pack fixed objects such as triangles, Hamilton cycles, or matchings. Well, we pack objects with similar property, then say they are triangle free and a small index number. Therefore, our result is a natural packing extension of Kim's result. Secondly, if you are not interested in packing problem, but in random graph processes, then you know that even in one run of the triangle free process or the semi-random variation of triangle free process, controlling the errors is very difficult. Well, we need to run the process for many iterations. Therefore, very important to control errors. Otherwise, the error term will take over. And for this purpose, we actually introduce some self-stabilization mechanism to control errors, which I will discuss later. And thirdly, if we are not interested in random graph processes, but in random theory, then similar as Kim's result, remove the actual log factor in the lower bound of random number R3T. Our result also establishes some conjecture in random theory by folks and others, which I will discuss in next slides. So, is there any question at this point? Okay, then we will move on to discuss such Ramsey conjecture. So here we consider the R-color version of Ramsey theory, and we consider a copy of some fixed graph H. We call a graph G is our Ramsey for H, and denoted by this notation G arrows H. If for any R-coloring of the edge of G, it contains a monochromatic copy of H. And we use this notation MRH to denote the collection of all are rendering MIMO graph G for H. Where are rendering MIMO for H means the graph G itself arrows H. But for any proper subgraph G prime of G, it has no arrows H. And many problems in Ramsey theory can be understood by studying the property of this collection, MRH. For example, Ramsey theorem tells us that this collection is not empty. And if you take the graph H to be the key vertex complete graph, and if you take MIMO over the number of vertices in this collection, then you will recover the classic Ramsey number. And if you take the minimum over the number of edges, then you will recover the valid study size Ramsey number. Well, we are interested in some other extremal parameter, and that was introduced by Burrow, Erdős, and Lovas in 1976. Here, we take the smallest minimum degree of the graph G in this collection and denoted by this notation SRH. And in the two color case, when H is a key vertex clique, then Burrow, Erdős, and Lovas completely determined this parameter in 1976. For many bipartite graph H, this parameter is determined by Fox and me, as well as Zabo, Zemstan, and Zercher. In 2015, Fox, Grace Peng, Yugno, Erzin, and Zabo, they initiated a study of the multiple color case. And when H is a K-vertex clique, they determine SRKK up to some logarithmic factor. And here for k fixed and r tending to infinity, really determine SRKK up to some logarithmic factor over here. Well, when k equals 3, in the special k equals 3 case, they also make some effort to make their bound as good as possible. And for the logarithm factor, there is a difference in the logarithm factor in the upper bound and the lower bound in their hoof. And they conjecture their lower bound is correct. So they conjecture that SRK3 is big O R squared times log R. Well, we put this conjecture as a corollary of our unpacking result. So it implies that, so we confirm this conjecture and implies that SRK3 has the order of magnitude of R squared times the log R. Let me mention that they have a net lemma to convert packing result such as ours to a bound on SRK3. In their paper, they actually sequentially pack GI via Lovas local lemma argument. So that's why there is an actual log factor in their upper bound. And to remove the logarithmic factor, they subject it to pipe GI sequentially via triangle three process. Well, for some technical reasons, we use semi-random variation of triangle three process to get our packing result. So is there a question at this point?
Yeah, this upper bound is that's a construction, right?
Yeah, for the upper bound, you need to get a constructor. Yeah, in the construct. Because you want to show there is some work. So let's move on to our main technical result to prove our technical result. So here is our main technical result to find the triangle free graph G in a dense graph H. So the result states that if you assume rho is some edge density and S is the size of some large vertex set, then if your host graph H is not too sparse, it means the number of edges between any disjoint vertex set A and B of size S, the number of edges between A and B in H is at least epsilon and size of A and size of B. Then we can find the triangle free graph G as a subgraph of H, so that the number of edges between A and B in G is roughly the edge density rho times the number of edges between A and B in H. And that is true for all the joint vertex at A and B of size I. So first of all, you can see that this number is greater than zero. Therefore, such graph G does not have even size outside at most of 2S. Therefore, such a graph G is a nearly optimal R3P graph. And this formula also tells us that the graph G behaves random-like because the number of edges between A and B in G is concentrated around the edge density rho times the number of edges between A and B in H. And this property we call semi-random property. And actually this semi-random property, this pseudo-random property, actually this formula we call it pseudo-random property. And actually this pseudo-random property guarantees that we can, after taking the graph G from H, then a similar fraction over all the local parts of edges remain. So that will imply our packing result. So here is why. Because then we start with H0 equal to the complete graph Kn. And then we sequentially choose graph Gi in Hi by using our main technique result, where Hi plays the role of H and Gi plays the role of G. And then we remove edges of Gi from Hi, get Hi plus one and repeat. Then this pseudo-random property guarantees that the number of edges between A and B in Hi is roughly this parameter times the number of edges between A and B in H0, which is size of A times size of B. Therefore, we can inductively apply our Mantegna result as long as this parameter is greater than epsilon. And we will stop when the number of edges between A and B in Hi is roughly epsilon fraction. And then a double counting argument implies that we have covered at least a 1 minus epsilon fraction of edges by the graph Gi that we have taken out. So that's how our Mantegna result implies our packing result. And as discussed, the proof of our Mantegna result is based on semi-random variation of channel free process, so that we do not require degree or co-degree regularity of the host graph H. Therefore, the graph H can just be a dense graph and not necessarily a complete graph. And as discussed, because we need to control the arrows over many iterations of the semi-random variation of triangle free process, therefore it's important to control arrows. And for this purpose, we introduce some self-stabilization mechanism built into the process to control arrows. Some of the probabilistic tools we used are bounded difference in cortices and some upper tier in cortices of one key. So next I will tell you how actually our technical result works and how do we prove this technical result. So this may be an excellent point for questions. So is there any question about this technical result?
So maybe just you could tell us a little bit about what is being stabilized? Is it the degree sequence or what exactly are you controlling?
Okay, yeah, I will discuss the self-deposition in next slide. So actually we just include more edges. I will discuss it a couple minutes later.
All right, thanks.
Okay. So let's move on to tell you how actually we prove our technical result. So recall that to prove our technical result, we try to find a pseudo-random triangle-free graph by semi-random variation of triangle-free process in a host graph H. Therefore, to construct this triangle-free graph with what we call TJ after many steps of the semi-random variation of triangle-free process. So we keep track iteratively of three kinds of edge sites. So the first kind of edge site is EJ, which you can assume that is the random site of edges. And the second kind of edge site is TJ, which is a subset of the randomized site EJ. And TJ is triangle free and has approximately equal size as the size of EJ. And the third kind of edge site we need to track is the open edge site. So for open edge site, we call that an edge is open if it is now in the randomized site EJ. And it does not create a triangle with any two edges of EJ. So as we have seen, if we have a triangle and two of the edges are in the edge site EJ, then the third one we call it closed and it cannot be in the open edge site OJ. So these are the three kinds of edge site we want to track. And the idea to track them in each step of the semi-random variation triangle-free process is that first we generate some random edge site, what we call gamma j plus one, in the open edge site OJ. And then we do some alteration of this random edge site gamma to get a subset gamma prime, so like the union of the triangle-free site TJ with this gamma prime is still triangle-free. And thirdly, we will update the open edge site OJ, which is the subset that we remove this random edge site gamma from the open edge site OJ. So that is the idea of each step. And then I will give you the definition of these three kind of auxiliary edge site. So indeed, we start with O0 equal to the edge site of the host graph H, which is a dense graph. And we set E0 and T0 equal to empty set at the beginning. Then as you can see, these three kind of site satisfy the relations over here. So that is the initial beginning of the algorithm. And then we need to define And then we need to construct them in inductively. So first, recall the idea here. So first we need to get some randomized set. So we get this randomized set gamma as a p random subset of the open edge set OJ. So we just include each edge of OJ independently with probability p to this randomized set gamma j plus one. And to construct the randomized set EJ plus one, we just take union of EJ with this randomized set we have chosen. Therefore, we have updated the randomized set EJ plus one. So at this moment, we have finished the first step over here. And next, because that we need to do some alteration on the edge set gamma j plus one to get a subset gamma prime. And we want to ensure that the triangle three side pj plus one constructed in this way has the similar size as the random edge set ej plus one. Therefore, we need to ensure that the size of this subset gamma prime is roughly the same as the size of the randomized set gamma. And how do we ensure that? That's because we can choose this p small enough so that you can imagine the randomized set gamma j plus one is really small. It means very few new triangles are created in the union of this gamma with EJ. Therefore, it's enough for us to remove very few edges to destroy all new triangles. Therefore, if we take the union of the subset with the triangle free set PJ, the graph is still triangle free. So that is our idea for us to ensure they are approximately equal. So let me point out that what kind of new triangles can be created in this type. So there are two cases. So the first case of creating a new triangle is that if we have a triangle and one of the edge is in the randomized set EJ and the other two edges in the open edge set OJ. And at this step, if we included both of them into the random edge set gamma j plus one, then a new triangle will be created. And we call such pair of edges in the random edge set bad pairs. And here is another case. If we have a triangle and all three edges of it are open, and we include them all together into the randomized set gamma j plus one to create a new triangle. So in this case, a new triangle is created, and we call such three edges bad triples. Therefore, to destroy all the new triangles after a moment solved, if we remove the edges of a maximal edge disjoint collection of bad pairs and bad triples, then we can destroy all the new triangles by removing such a maximal collection. And that's how we define the subset gamma prime. We just remove the maximal collection of edges from the randomized set gamma. And then if we take union of this gamma prime with the triangle free side TJ, then we will get a triangle free side TJ plus one. Therefore, we have updated the triangle free side TJ plus one. That is by the maximality of this collection we remove. And the reason that we remove a maximal collection of edges over here rather than remove one edge from each bad pairs and bad triples is that it's actually much easier to analyze because of the disjoint names. So that's why we remove a maximal collection rather than remove each edge from the bad triples or bad pairs. At this moment, we have updated the triangle free set, TJ plus one, and finished the second step. And then the last step is to update the open edge set, OJ plus one. And I will tell you how does it work. So recall that we want OJ plus one does not intersect with EJ plus one. Therefore, we need to remove the randomized set gamma j plus one from OJ. And because we want the edges in the open edge set are open, that means we need to remove some closed edges. So for the closed edges in this step, and there are two cases. So the first case is that if we have a triangle and one of the edge is in EJ and the other two edges are in OJ. And if we include one of them into the randomized set gamma J plus one, then the third edge will become closed. Therefore, we need to remove these closed edges from OJ to get OJ plus one. And another case is that if we have three edges for a triangle in the open edge set OJ, and we include two of them into the randomized set gamma j plus one, then the third one will become closed. And we need to remove these closed edges from the open edge set OJ. So the first two parts are easier to understand. And actually, we also remove some actual edges for technical reasons. And I will explain it to you. And actually, this part of edges is related to the cell's deposition mechanism. Let me explain it to you why we need to remove such actual edges for technical reasons. So actually, we remove some actual random edges. And here is the reason why. So for example, if you have an edge E, which is UV, and if you consider the co-pair of edges on A, and one of the pair of edges is in the edge side EJ, and the other edge is in the edge side, open edge side OJ. And as you can see, if we add any of the open edge side over here, we will close this edge UV. And we denote the number of such co-pairs by YE. So such co-pair means, I mean, one pair is in EJ and the other pair is in OJ. And therefore, the probability is that an edge E is not closed in next step, it's roughly none of these open edges is included in the randomized set gamma j plus one. Therefore, it is roughly one minus p to the power of number of such co-pairs. And let me mention that they have approximately equal here. It is because there is another case that we have a co-pair and two of them are open and we include both of them into the randomized set gamma. But as you can imagine, in that case, the probability is very small. So that is rather negligible. So therefore, we have the probability that E is not closed is roughly this probability. But as you can see, this probability really depends on the edge E, depends on this parameter. On this parameter, YE can actually vary edges from edges because we do not assume regularity of the host graph. and that will cause some problem. So to overcome this difficulty, we actually remove some actual random edges independently with probability QE. So we remove the edges independently with probability QE, and therefore an edge is not closed, or an actual edge is roughly this probability times 1 minus QE. And because we can choose this parameter probability PE, QE, up to different edges E, therefore we can make this probability is roughly the same for all the edges E. And that is what we call self-deposition mechanism. And that is also a key difference between Auer's proof and Kim's proof. Well, in Kim's proof, to get this self-deposition, Kim used some earlier regulation result by Kahn to artificially modify the graph to make it self-deposition. Well, here we just include some actual random edges, which is much easier to implement in algorithms. So here is what we call self-deposition mechanism. And at this moment, we have updated the open edge side, OJ plus one. That is, we remove the random edge side and the closed edge side and some actual random edge side from the open edge side in last step. And therefore, at this moment, we have updated all of these three kinds of auxiliary edge side, and then we can move on to next step. So that's how the semi-random variation of channel free process works in the proof of our technical result. And by analyze such semi-random variation of channel free process, we can show that the number of edges between any two large vertex sites A and B, the number of edges between them in the open edge site is roughly parameter QJ times size of A times size of B, where QJ satisfies some differential equation. And here we assume the host graph H is the complete graph for ease of illustration. So that's why we have size of A times size of B over here. Otherwise, if you just assume H is a dense graph, then we should have the number of edges between A and B in H. And I will tell you how this result implies our Montecuhn result. Because I to get our Montecuhn result, we want the number of edges between A and B in the final triangle free side TJ is roughly the exponential times size of A times size of B. And let me tell you how does it work. So here we choose the probability P to be some small parameter sigma over square root of N, where P is the probability that an edge in the open edge side is included into the random edge side gamma. And let me tell you how this result will imply our Montecuhn result. So actually consider the number of edges between A and B in the final triangle free site. We can decompose such edge site to the step that they are included in the triangle free site TJ. Therefore, the number of edge site A and B in the final triangle free site is the sum of the step that they are included into the triangle free site. So that's why the first equality holds here. And recall that we want the difference between the triangle free site is roughly the same as the size of the randomized site gamma j plus one. So that's why we have approximate equal over here. because we need to keep, recall that we need to keep gamma prime is roughly same as the size of gamma. And because this gamma randomized site is just a P randomized site of the open edge site OJ, therefore the size of this term is roughly the probability P times the number of edges between A and B in the open edge site. And if we plug P in, and if we use this concentration log and plug it in, we will have this type. And because QJ satisfies some differential equation, therefore this discrete sum is approximately equal to this integral. Therefore, we can approximate this discrete sum by this integral. And then if we apply the fundamental theorem of calculus, this integral is roughly equal to this function over square root of n times s of a times s of b. And by studying the behavior of this function, we can show that this function is approximately equal to square root of beta times log n. And recall that this parameter is what we define for the edge density rho. Therefore, we have shown that the triangle free site TJ, the number of edges between A and B in the triangle free site TJ is roughly, has edge density roughly rho according to the host graph H. So recall that if we use host graph H not to be a complete graph, but some dense graph, then here, instead of size of A and size of B, we will get the number of edges between A and B in H. So that's how we prove our Mantegna result. Let me mention that actually things are not so quite easy to get this concentration result. And I will explain to you why. It is because we try to get such concentration in concentration for all the large vertices at A and B, and that will cause some difficulty. And here is why. So assume we have a vertex V1 and it has many edges in the many neighbors in the randomized set EJ. So they have the neighbors over here. And V1 can have some open neighbor. That is what we call V2. So V1 and V2 is an open edge. And as you can imagine, there are many common open neighbor of V2 with the neighbor of V1 that is in the randomized set EJ. So you can assume there are many common neighbors over here. And then we can choose the large vertex set A to be a vertex set that contains the neighbor of V1 in EJ. We choose this one to be A, and then we choose some vertex at B, which contains the vertex at V2. Then for this pair of large vertex sites, then if at next step, we include this open edge V1 and V2 into the randomized site gamma J plus one, then as you can see, there such common neighbor will become closed, and as you can see a large number of open edges between A and B are closed. So that will cause some difficulty for us to apply concentration inequalities because of this large change at this step. And we want the concentration holds for all the large vertices at A and B. And that will cause some difficulty and need some more careful analyze. So let me not go into the details about these technical details. rather than I will go to summary. So as a summary, instead of finding just one nearly optimal R3T graph as Kim and Bowman did, we find an almost packing of nearly optimal R3T graphs. It means given any epsilon greater than zero, we can nearly decompose the complete graph Kn by a collection of edge disjoint graph Gi, such that the graph Gi in this collection contains at least a 1 minus epsilon fraction of edges of the complete graph Kn. And each of the graph Gi in this collection is triangle free and with small inverse number. So as remarked, our result is a natural packing extension of Kim's result. And we can obtain our packing result with high probability by a polynomial time random mass algorithm, not just showing the existence. And secondly, our packing result establishes the conjecture about this parameter SRK3 in random theory by folks and others. So let me start with two questions. So for the first one, actually to prove this upper bound on this random parameter SRK3, it is enough to just cover epsilon fraction of edges. Will we cover 1 minus epsilon fraction of edges by our packing result? So we are wondering, is there any application about our stronger packing result? So maybe in random theory. And the second question, so if one generalizes the greedy packing result, then it turns out that it does not help to improve the upper bound on SRKK for larger K. It is because there are better construction based on projective lens. Therefore, we are wondering, is there any application of the random gradient version of KK-free process will be useful? And this talk is based on a paper by me and Wenqi, which has the same title as this talk, and it has recently been published at Combinatorica. Let me stop here. Thank you. Is there any question?
Thank you, Huff. Let's go ahead and thank our speaker if we could, and then we'll go ahead and open it up for any questions. Okay, do we have any questions for our speaker?
You may have mentioned this, but so with this algorithm, when do you stop? Or when, I guess, are you forced to stop at some point, right? Because you would have put too many edges in. I don't know if that question makes sense, but.
Yeah. Actually, there are two levels of iteration. So here, this is the higher level of iteration. We iteratively use our Manhattan result to get the graph Gi in the packing collection. So recall that each time we remove so many fraction of edges, then the remaining fraction of edges is roughly this one. I know that if you want to apply this Manhattan result, you need to guarantee that there are still enough number of edges are left. So that's why we need to keep this parameter is at least epsilon. And then we will stop when this parameter is roughly epsilon.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
Actually, a follow-up question to that. So how dense is the graph that's left over? What is epsilon basically?
So for the graph left over, actually we still have epsilon fraction of edges left over. Actually, you can use this formula to guarantee that in the leftover graph in HI, this parameter is roughly epsilon. So roughly a epsilon fraction of edges are left over.
Yeah, what is epsilon, I guess, is what I'm asking. How sparse is the remaining piece?
For the epsilon, you can choose the epsilon to be any constant greater than zero.
But you could also take it tending to zero. How fast? You don't know, maybe?
But then you see maybe change. That is the minimum number, will change. C actually depends on something like 1 word epsilon square or something.
I guess another question actually, the K4 is, it'd be nice to have the Ramsey result for K4 as well. Because that's not tight still, I recall. And you don't need the packing result for that, right? We just need the construction. So have you tried your methods on K4?
Yeah, actually we have some. Work in progress, not just for K4, but for H3 graphs. And H can be many kind of graphs. So the result is very similar as this one. It powers one that's equal fraction of edges and has some unique number.
Do we have any other questions for our speaker? Okay, in that case, thanks, Huff, for coming around. It was a great talk. Good to have you. We're all happy to have you here. And I guess we'll go ahead and sign off. Unless Josh, is there anything else you want to say?
Nope. Thanks very much.
Well, actually, for H3 result, we can guide H2 be maybe a clique or cycles by part of graph. Thanks for attending.
Thanks.
Thanks, everybody.
That was a very nice talk. Yeah, it's a very nice technique, so thank you.
All right, thanks, Pete.